in today's session, I like to do a little bit coding and discuss some software designs, and I will show you a few implementations of the methods we have discussed so far. Yeah? So what have we done so far in numerical methods? We had a chapter, a small one, on computer arithmetic. This will be touched a little bit today. Then we had a session on the Monte Carlo method, so generation of random numbers, uniform, other distributions, using that to calculate the expectation or the integral. And we had a session on the time discretization of stochastic processes. And so if you like to use this in a computer, yeah, it's a numerical method, so we like to use it in a computer. And you maybe are in the situation that it could be that you have to use this code again. Yeah, you should think about some design aspects. So this is what I will like, what I would like to discuss also a little bit, yeah, today. So I have a few remarks on software design or object-oriented implementation. And doing this, well, from the beginning is a good pace off later. It will take a little bit more time, but it starts you thinking about your problem, and maybe you also get a better structure or of your problem, and you understand your problem. So let's start here with the first remarks before I show you a little bit this stuff in the code. So you should perform some kind of abstraction of the mathematical concepts. So we have seen, for example, different things: random numbers, random number sequences, a random variable sampled by a random number sequence, a Brownian motion, a stochastic process. So what should be, maybe if you think of an object-oriented language like Java, Scala, whatever, yeah, or an object functional language, what should be a class? What should be an interface? Yeah, where do you cut your mathematical concept? Is, for example, the random number generator part of the Brownian motion? Yeah? Is everything inside a big class that generates a Brownian motion, or should that be cut? And this question, if it should be cut into two different parts in the computer program, is related if you like to use one part in different applications. For example, a random number generator is useful to generate a Brownian motion, or say an approximation, a sampling of a Brownian motion, but maybe you need it in other situations too. And an interface actually encapsulates, yeah, you had a session on the Java programming language, so you know these words: encapsulation, interfaces, classes. An interface encapsulates your implementation, so how you do it, from the specification, what can be done. Yeah? What can be done are the methods which are available to the user. Yeah, so this is already a big step to have a good definition of the interface, so what can be done, and then have an implementation how it can be done. Because you saw that generating a random number sequence can be done in different ways, and maybe you like to try out different implementations. Yeah, so then you specify first the interface, you implement your application, and then you can try out different implementations of this interface. So this is how you split your problem. Yeah, and also it is maybe related to the mathematical concept, because if you are a mathematician, you have a good understanding of the concept. So this gives you already an indication of what are the right boundaries where you should split your problem. When you create now a composition, that is to say you use different parts, different classes, different interfaces, and you compose them to something new. So what could that be? For example, a Brownian motion is a stochastic process. And if you consider the Euler scheme approximation of a point in motion, where each random variable is sampled using the Monte Carlo method, then you see there are inside this point in motion different components. For example, the time discretization, the random number generator, the method that performs the inversion from uniform to normal. So if all these components are individual parts of your program, then you compose them together to get a bigger concept, something bigger, the point in motion, for example. And when you perform compositions, you should check what belongs together. For example, the strike of a call option, does it belong to the Black-Scholes model? No. It belongs to the financial product. The model and the financial product are two different concepts. Yeah. So you should maybe have some tidied up decomposition and then composition of your problem. So here, maybe I write here example for a composition. So point in motion. Consists of a time discretization. And a random number generator. And maybe more things. Okay, so that was maybe a fairly general remark. And you see, I cannot be so precise here. Yeah, and this also hints that doing a nice design is maybe also some kind of art. Yeah, there are a few rules, but sometimes it's also good to break the rules. And do not be afraid of doing mistakes, because there are nice tools that allow you to rearrange your stuff later. Yeah? A second aspect is that you should design your program for extension. So when you start writing it, consider possible mathematical generalization. So for example, in the Black-Scholes model, I will review it again in a few seconds. You know that the SDE is DS is RS DT plus sigma DW, where R and sigma are constants. And if you already know that you perform an Euler discretization using the logarithm, yeah, then you have D log S is R minus 1/2 sigma squared DT. Sorry, there is an S here in front. The DW, it's a log normal process, plus sigma DW. Then you'll see the coefficients are constant. And it could be that you start implementing your Euler scheme with constant coefficients, because you know you can transform your problem to such a situation. But there are many mathematical models, yeah, Liber market model, Heston model, where the drift and the diffusion parameters, so the mu and the sigma, are stochastic. Yeah, so consider already the general case. And in the beginning, your program doesn't use this. So have some design for extension. For example, with the Brownian motion, we start using a vector valued Brownian motion from the beginning, even if in this course we just use a one-dimensional Brownian motion. And then my last advice here in this small remark is that you should implement readable code. So maybe just try to write it such that you write it like a documentation. Yeah. So what does the Black-Scholes model do? Be concise and readable instead of trying to be as fast as possible. Yeah. So I wouldn't sacrifice readability over performance, because performance, yeah, so speed of the program, can be achieved later, often by different ways, yeah, by other ways. And sometimes it's not such a big problem to be 20% slower. Yeah, but if the code is readable, you avoid of a lot of errors and stuff like this. And the Java virtual machine is a brilliant thing. Yeah, it optimizes your code on the fly, and even if you write it more lengthy, yeah, sometimes the optimizer is just removing this for you. Okay, so I like to practice this a little bit with you, and what we do today will lead to another session where we will review a few implementations, which you then could use in your exercises and assignments. And also it illustrates maybe these aspects and reviews a little bit the theory we did. And I would like to illustrate it with two applications. The first one is just value a call option under the Black-Scholes model. We already did this and discussed this. And the next one is simulate an Euler scheme for the Black-Scholes model. For example, you could then evaluate a more complicated product like an Asian option. So before I start coding, let's review again the theory, which I like to implement. So we know from the universal pricing theorem that you can express the value of a financial derivative as an expectation. Yeah? So the value of a financial derivative in time little t can be expressed as an expectation. So there is an expectation operator here of the value at a future point in time multiplied with some ratio of the numerators. So the numerator relative value is a martingale, that doesn't matter so much here. And this value at a future point in time here is for a financial product sometimes known as a function of some other random variable. For example, for a call option, it is a function of the underlying asset S of T, and this function is the maximum of S minus K and zero. Yeah? So you know that this is a function of a random variable. A function of a random variable is again a random variable. And so you can write it as some function of S of T. The next step, yeah, so the function G is maximum of the argument minus K and zero multiplied with the ratio of the numerators. This argument, the S of T, is then modeled, yeah, by a mathematical model, by a stochastic process. We use the Black-Scholes model. So under the Black-Scholes model, you know that S of T at a later point in time is a function of the model parameters and the initial value and some normal distributed random variable. And we know how to numerically create normal distributed random variables. So here we have our green part, the log S of T, and this is in the Black-Scholes model a function of model parameters, yeah, and the model uses the Brownian motion as a driver. So it is logarithm of the initial value plus some drift, which changes the mean, plus some normal distributed random variable. So if you transform back, that is actually an application of Itô's lemma here. Yeah. Then you have S at a later point in time is a function of model parameters and a normal distributed random variable. So there is a normal distributed random variable here, the X. Yeah. X is normal distributed with mean zero and standard deviation square root of T. Yeah. So x is square root of t times z, where z is standard normal. Okay, so now you see I had several parts. So we had, I used the green one for the g. So let's play a little bit with the colors here. So let's mark the g here in green. The g describes our financial product, and let's mark the s here in red, which describes the value that comes from the model. Yeah, so green is financial product, red is the model. So let's color this here red. This is our model. Okay, which gives us the s. And we have to calculate an expectation of a random variable. What is generating the random variable is the x. So let's color this blue. And you see that already here we have kind of decomposition into different parts. There is the financial model generating the S, which is the Euler scheme of the Black-Scholes model and so on, the model. There is the financial product, so the function G, which is generating the payoff. So it's a function of the model, so which is specified here. Yeah, the function G. And then there is, take the expectation of a random variable generated from a function of X, which is maybe related to the numerical method. How do we generate random variables, random numbers? So the three parts, the blue one, expectation of the random variable, the green one, the mathematical, the financial product, the function defining the financial product, and the red one, the model. So in the end, we have actually these parts. Yeah. So we have the financial product is a function of the model applied to a normal distributed random variable generated from some numerical method, taking the expectation. Okay, so maybe we can label this here a little bit. So this function here is the financial product. This function here is the model, the Black-Scholes model, and this random variable will be generated by a numerical method, or approximated. Let's say approximated is maybe better. Yeah, and then we have a numerical method that calculates expectation. There's the Kahan summation maybe inside. Yeah, so you see, we will also touch computer arithmetic. So let's try this a little bit in code, and I would like to show you three or four, or maybe five, I don't know, let's see, different ways of doing this. Yeah, and so why I show you so many different ways? So maybe this is to just illustrate you the disadvantage and advantages of some of these approaches I'm using. So I create here a new class. I would like to have a main method, and let's call this Monte Carlo Black-Scholes experiment. Do we have something like this? No. Okay. We didn't do it. And I would like to perform the valuation of a call option on the of the Black-Scholes model. So let's specify the model here. So we have some parameters, say the initial value of the model is 100. So the stock is currently at 100. The drift, the risk-free rate, the R parameter of the Black-Scholes model is say 5%. And the volatility of the model is maybe 20%. And with these model parameters, I would like to evaluate financial derivative. So the option maturity is say 1 year, so it's one. Has a strike, it's a call option, so the option strike is say 105, yeah, so 5% higher as the starting value. So it's approximately where the expectation is. So, and you see, I already decomposed a little bit model product. So we like to do a Monte Carlo method. So I need a seed for the random number generator. Let's take some value, 32, 16, I don't know. We need some sampling. So let's take 10 to 2 times 10 to the 7, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Yeah. So that's 2 times 10 to the power of 7. Okay, let's try this with these parameters. Okay, since I wrote these parameters here as fields of the class, yeah, let's create here this class. So I write Monte Carlo Black-Scholes experiment, new experiment. So now here, when I create new, he will initialize all these variables. And now you can perform some calculations. First, let's try the analytic value, get an analytic value, because there's a Black-Scholes formula. Yeah, and let's print this out. So so this is my analytic value here I would like to print. He doesn't have this method here, so I create it, yeah, here. And well, I will use today the FinMAT library, and there is an analytic formula inside. Yeah, so I just use this. So there is an analytic formula for the Black-Scholes model. So we have to search a little bit. Black-Scholes option value forward. Where is it? Option data. This one seems maybe nice, yeah? This takes the initial value, the risk-free rate, the volatility, the option maturity, the option strike. So all the parameters we have specified is taken here. The initial stock value, yeah? So we had a different name, initial value, risk-free rate, volatility. So there's a typo here. Okay. Option maturity, option strike, yeah? So that's what we need. And the return type here is a double. Okay, so maybe I just run this program and check if the result looks reasonable. So we started at 100, so the option value is 8, so it's 8% from the initial value. Okay, maybe that's reasonable. So let's start another experiment, and my next one is Monte Carlo, and we will have different versions of the Monte Carlo implementation, so let's call this Monte Carlo 1, and I just like to do it very old style, yeah? So get Monte Carlo value using a for loop, yeah, very old school, and a random number generator. But maybe you see a lot from this, so because you see each step which we do. So when I like to do this, I need random numbers, and then I would like to loop over the random numbers and calculate the Monte Carlo integral. Okay, so let's create uniform random numbers. So we already had this, so we had a Mersenne twister. Yeah, so let's just use a Mersenne twister. So you see here, I already have decomposed my mathematical problem into different parts. One part is I have something which generates random numbers. So then I would like to calculate the sum, namely the Monte Carlo sum. So let's initialize this value here, and then we loop over all sample indices. So let's loop from zero to number of samples. Sample index plus plus. And now let's get a uniform random number. So uniform is Mersenne next double. So which gives me the next uniform random numbers. So this here is a zero, it's not a double. Next step is I would like to transform this uniform to a normal distributed. So we had a session on this. How do we do this? There is, for example, the ICDF method, yeah, inversion of the correlated distribution function. And there is somewhere an implementation of the normal distribution where we have this, the inversion, inverse cumulative distribution function. Yes, several implementations. So we just use this on our uniform. So by the way, if I do something like this here, so I write normal distribution, I press Control Tab to get this selection. And this completion. And sometimes if you do this in your IDE Eclipse, yeah, just a small remark, he doesn't show you anything. So if this happens in Eclipse, so you can go to preferences, and in Java there is in the editor a so-called content assistant, yeah, the content assistant, where you can actually enable these things. And you see here, Java proposals is here checked. Yeah, so if I uncheck this, and I now write here normal, yeah, and I see nothing, yeah, normal, because he doesn't propose me anything. So you can enable this here in the content assessed to have the Java proposals. You can also have more proposals. And if you now press Control Tab, he will show you some selections. So which is then the reason why I can type so fast here. Okay. So now we have a normal distributed one. So if we go back to our problem, now we have created the X. We have sampled the X, okay? A normal distributed. Actually, we have created the Z, yeah, the standard normal, because this is a standard normal. So next thing is to create the X and then apply the H. Okay, so next thing is we create the S, so the underlying. So this here is the Black-Scholes model. So the Black-Scholes model tells me this is the initial value multiplied with the exponential of, yeah, and then from this we have the risk-free rate, S times exponential R delta T. So delta T is here the option maturity, yeah, T, minus 1/2 sigma squared, so volatility squared, times delta T. Okay, that's the drift part plus the diffusion part, so volatility times the normal distributed random number. So square root of option maturity times normal. Okay, so that is actually the S. Yeah. So uniform, then the Z, then the S. So the next one is the payoff. The payoff of the call option is the maximum of the underlying minus the strike, the option strike, and zero. Okay. And then the sum is the payoff. Let's write it like this. So the payoff summed up, but it is not the payoff, it is the discounted payoff. So we have to multiply here with the ratio of the numerator. And you know that under the Black-Scholes model, here in this situation, if I have the R here, yeah, I use the numerator e to the RT. Yeah, so I have to divide it. So it's e to the minus RT. So that's valuation of the Black-Scholes model on all paths. This is here the omega, which we have sampled. This is our Monte Carlo sum. So the value is the sum divided by the sample points. It's 1 over n, the value summed up. Okay, so let's return this. Okay, and let's try this program. Yeah, the return value is now a double. And let's see if this is correct. Yeah, he does a Monte Carlo simulation. We have some kind of Monte Carlo error. Yeah, it's up to 1, 2, 3 digits. Yeah, but you know, it's square root of the number of paths. Yeah, so actually it's 3 digits. It's 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 4, the error, which is in line with the theory. Okay, so there is a disadvantage of this way of implementing it. Everything is very much glued together. Yeah, so you do all the concepts here in a single block, and then you have the loop around this. Let's try an alternative. So let's call this Monte Carlo 2. Yeah, and we use the Java Stream API. We did this before, the Java Stream API. Let's create this method which will calculate the value using the Java Stream API. A stream is just a sequence of numbers, and this already allows us to create a little bit more abstraction. So first, let's create a normal distributed stream, which defines the model. Yeah? So a normal distributed stream, we get it from the double stream. So let's create a normal distributed stream. So in double stream, there is a method called generate, which takes such a double supplier. And actually, we can use MerzenTwister as a double supplier. So, oh, this is not a normal. This is a uniform one. So let's call it uniform. So a uniform stream, which is generated from MerzenTwister. And in our application, the stream should not be infinite. So let's limit it to how many numbers? Number of samples. So now make this stream of uniform random numbers a stream of normals. So I use uniform. I apply a function to each element, and the function which I apply is here the inverse distribution function. So normal distribution inverse. Why doesn't he give me a completion here? I don't know. Inverse distribution function. So like this. Okay, this means take this function, inverse distribution function, and apply it to every element of this sequence, which will then generate a new sequence, a sequence of normal distributed random numbers. So from that, I can now create the underlyings. And now we can define our model. So our model is a function which maps a number to a number, namely the normal distributed z to the log normal distributed s. So we can now define, this is an double operator, an operator from double to double, our model. And this operator maps, say, the Z to, now comes the Black-Scholes model. So it's an initial value multiplied with the exponential of the risk-free rate. Okay, just copy this here. And here is the Z, okay? So this is exactly this function which we had here on the, this is exactly this function H, which we have here, yeah? Which maps the Z, no, it's not H, yeah? H maps the X, maybe I should better write Z. So which maps the Z to the S of T. Okay, so then I can transform the stream above to the underlying values. So this is just the normal distributed random numbers and applied the model to it. Okay. So next thing is the payoff or the discounted payoff of the financial product. So the discounted payoff maps now the S, yeah, which we have, to the maximum of S minus option strike and zero multiplied with the exponential. Maybe I take a new line, the exponential of minus R T. Yeah? And you see, except from the little thing that there is a model parameter here, these are, this is option strike. These are the product parameters. So this is the financial product. And these are the model parameters. So this is the model. So this is now the sequence of payoffs. And from that, we have to take the average. Yeah? So this is double the value is the sum of all these values divided by the number of samples. So what's going on here? I have to, this here is just the function. I have now apply the function to the stream, yeah? So the stream of payoff values is the stream of underlyings, and then apply the payoff function to this. So now I can take the back value. Okay, so, and I return the value. Okay, so this looks very similar to what we did here, except that the loop is gone. The loop is replaced by, we use an object which represents the stream. Yeah, so the object always represents all the numbers. So it looks like a little bit we operate on vectors. Yeah, all the operations we perform here operate on vectors. And now you can actually rearrange the code a little bit. For example, this function here, we can specify it here on the top. It's the specification of the financial model used, the Black-Scholes model. So this function can be specified here. So this is the model. This is the product. So there's a little bit nicer structure here, the product. And here comes the numerical method. Yeah, so these are just functions. And the numerical method is use Mersenne Twister ICDF transformation, and then apply to this the model and the product. Yeah, so combine the three parts. So, and actually these functions do not know anything about the fact that we use Monte Carlo. So let's keep fingers crossed. I wonder if everything is right here. Okay. So we get a slightly different value. Actually, the value looks worse. So why does the value look worse? Did I do a mistake? Looks right. Okay, so maybe we continue. Maybe you see something. Why this is such a big difference, or maybe it's okay. So why does the stream know which function of Mersenne? This is a good question. So there was the question, how does generate, so in the chat, how does generate know which method of Mersenne he is using? Yeah, so if you look here on generate, you can also open it if you like. You see the argument of generate is a double supplier. And a double supplier, there's a little I here, is an interface. Okay, so let's take a look at this interface. The interface of a double supplier is it has a method get as double. So this is the method that he's using. Yeah. So you have to look at the specification of this method generate. So now the Mersenne, let's take a look at this Mersenne twister. Here I used the method next double. Yeah, and your question is correct. He is actually not using that method. He is using a different method. And we just have to take a look at this declaration here of the Mersenne twister. And you see Mersenne twister implements this interface here, random number generator one dimensional. And if you look into this interface, then it also implements the double supplier. So it has a method next double, but somewhere below, it also has the function get as double, which is just a synonym, an alias for the other function. Yeah? So by doing this little trick here, the generate calls this function. Very good question. Okay. Yes, now I know why the value is so different. I forgot the seat here. Yeah? So this is a Mersenne twister without a seat. This is also a Mersenne twister without a seat. So when we run it again and again, the values should be different. Let's see. Or does he use a default seat? I don't know. Let's check. What is Mersenne twister doing if we, yes. Yeah, if we don't do a seat, he's just using... Oops. So we forgot our parameter Monte Carlo seat. You also see it here. It is yellow. There's a little exclamation mark, which means pay attention. You never use this value. Okay, so let's use our Monte Carlo seat. So both implementations use the same Monte Carlo seat. And now let's check again. Okay, so that was using the Java stream API, and you see this already allows us to do a little bit nicer structuring of our mathematical problem. There's still a small difference between the two here. Anybody knowing where this difference comes from? So the point is, if you look here into the summation method, yeah, then the guy who is writing here the description somewhere tells us that, let's see, this is using an error correction. I don't know, where is it? So the method may be implemented using compensated summation. Yeah, this is actually the Kahan summation, which is used here in this implementation. Okay. So that explains this little difference. This one is with error correction. This one is without. I would like to do a last one, a last method of implementing this. And now I use parts from the library. I use a random variable and a Brownian motion. I will explain these later. Let's just create this method. Sorry, what did I do? Create the method, okay. And so I will later review the implementations, but in this library, there is a class encapsulating the concept of a random variable and the concept of a Brownian motion. Yeah. So the random variable is actually similar to the stream. It's just a vector of double values. And the Brownian motion is actually the generation of the X. Yeah. So it contains the random number generator used, the inversion of the distribution function, and generates the X. Yeah? And then we can apply the model and the payoff. Yeah? So let's start again by generating uniform random numbers. So now I would like to use a Brownian motion. And a Brownian motion, as I explained, consists of a time discretization and or a sampling of the Brownian motion and the random number generator. So I have a concept for a time discretization. So let's use the time discretization implementation. So there are several implementations here, and you see there are several constructors. For example, there's a constructor here taking the initial value. Oh no, that one is maybe too complicated. So, which one would I like to have here? There's a constructor taking the initial value, the number of time step, and the time step size. And I would like to have a very primitive time discretization with just one time step. Yeah, from zero to the option maturity. That is to say, my delta W of the Brownian motion will be just the X, yeah, in this little problem here. Yeah? So the X is just a Brownian increment over this big time step. Okay, so now we have a Brownian motion, which we can create from these things. Yeah, so there is the Brownian motion. So you see there are some implementations of Brownian motions. So Brownian motion from send random numbers, or Brownian motion from random number generator. And this one takes a time discretization, takes a random number generator, takes the number of paths, and a number of factors, because it is already a vector-valued Brownian motion. So we take the time discretization, one number of factors is one, it's just a one-dimensional Brownian motion, and number of paths is our number of samples in our problem here. Number of samples. Okay, so these are our arguments, and the random number generator is the Mersenne. Number of samples. Oh, he likes to have an integer here. Okay. So that one is an implementation which can generate the Brownian motion. Okay. So everything is now a little bit encapsulated and hidden. This is how a time discretization is created. This is how Brownian motion is created. Okay. And what's actually the return value of the Brownian motion? So the Brownian motion, you can ask it, get Brownian increment for a certain time index or for a certain time. So let's get the increment for time zero. It is a vector valued function. Yeah. So this here returns me the delta W J, yeah, delta W J, delta W zero, yeah, because it is a just one dimensional one, at a given time step, which is the increment from T I to T I plus one, which is the increment from zero to optimal true T. Okay, and the return value for this function here is a random variable. Okay, so we have now a concept of a random variable. Or let's call this here delta W, or the X. Okay, and now I can write everything from my code. So actually I'm doing it a little bit like in this loop here, but now I can write everything in terms of random variables. And actually I do not care how the random variables are generated. Yeah? So this here is the numerical method hidden inside. And now we write our, mathematical problem in a much more natural way. So first the drift of the model. Yeah. So this is the risk-free rate times option maturity minus 1/2 volatility squared times option maturity. This is the drift of the SDE. Then the diffusion is again a random variable. And the diffusion is sigma times Brownian motion. Yeah? So it's Brownian motion multiplied, it's delta W multiplied with volatility, sigma times delta W. So the random variable has a multiplication. Okay, we can multiply a random variable with a number and get another random variable. So then the underlying of the from the Plek-Scholz model, yeah, is that diffusion plus the drift. From that we take the exponential and we multiply with the initial value. This is the model. Okay, then comes the product. The product is, take this random variable and create a new one, namely the payoff, the discounted payoff, which is take the underlying, subtract the strike, the option strike, option strike. Take from that the maximum and zero. So there's a function floor doing this. Yeah, take the maximum of x and floor, so floor at zero. And from that, then we have the random variable of all the discounted payoffs. Wait, discounted. So we have to multiply with the exponential minus r times t. Okay. Then we have the random variable of discounted payoffs. And now perform the evaluation. So the valuation is take the expectation of this. Yeah? So let's call payoff, and there is a function getAverage. Yeah? Or there's also a function average, which creates a random variable, the random variable of the expectation. And from that, you can create the get the value. Okay, so let's try this. Yeah, it's a third way of doing this. Okay, so let's check if we did everything correct here. The third way of implementing this. And you have here now, very similar to the other approaches, an encapsulation in classes. Yeah? So on the right-hand side, you see a class implementing a time discretization. On the left-hand side, you see an interface representing a time discretization. So let's look in this interface. So the interface of a time discretization has the number of times, the number of time steps. It can give you a time for a given index. It can give you a time step for a given index, yeah, and it can give you maybe some other stuff. Yeah, so the index for a given time, yeah, rounding to the next index. We have a Brownian motion. Yeah, so the Brownian motion is an interface. We can have a look into this interface, and it can give you the Brownian increment for a certain time index and a certain vector. Yeah, so it is vector valued. It can also give you this for a time. As a double, it just looks this up in a time discretization. Okay, so and we have the concept of a random variable. So a random variable is just an object which has some arithmetic methods. So you could say it's just a field. Yeah. So you can divide the random variable by a value. You can multiply the random variable with a value. You can also take exponential square root and all this. Yeah. You can add another random variable to it. Yes. You can perform arithmetic operations. And there are also operations like take the expectation or take the average. Yeah. So there is here an average somewhere. So there is a get average, which gives you a double, or an average, which gives you a random variable where every value is on every pass is the same. Okay, so these classes somehow encapsulate our mathematical concepts. And then what comes here is our problem written on a very abstract way. You might now say, okay, this is not very readable with this add, take exponential multiply. Yeah, it's like a Polish notation on a calculator. So it looks a little bit inconvenient, yeah, to write like this. Actually, you can get used to this. And the reason why I have to do this, I cannot use here a plus, yeah, because it's not allowed to have method names that start with a symbol, yeah, that have a symbol inside. But this is just a syntax problem. And I would like to show you a fourth method. Recall this is 8022 here. And the fourth method, I wrote it in Scala. Scala is another programming language. And here I have the program in Scala. And in Scala, actually, you see this is now exactly the same. Yeah. So I create the Meersenne random numbers. I create the time discretization. I create the Brownian motion. And then you see I have the same lines here. I calculate the drift. I calculate the diffusion. And you see the diffusion is the volatility multiplied with the Brownian increment. And I use here a multiplication sign. Yeah. And the thing on the left-hand side, the diffusion, is a random variable. Okay, so I use the multiplication sign. And here you see initial value, this is a double, and the drift is a double, the diffusion is a random variable. I use just a plus here, I use just an exponential here, and the thing which is on the left-hand side is a random variable. So I can write now my problem in a very nice way. Yeah, and the same with the maximum, and even here with the expectation. Yeah, the expectation is just a function which takes a random variable and returns a random variable. So I get here the expectation, and from that I just take the double value. Actually, this is just a little bit of syntax magic, so-called syntactic sugar at work here, because in the Scala programming language, you can have methods where the method name is a symbol. Yeah? So plus, yeah. So the plus sign here is a valid method name. So first, let's run this program here. I'm using now IntelliJ because the Scala support in IntelliJ is a little bit nicer. I run this program. So now he runs this here, and we should hopefully see some output. Yeah, and you see, I get the same number as in the Eclipse project. Yeah, even with the last digit here, the same number. He does the same. It's 8.0. And so maybe just for illustration, I show you why Scala, why you can write this a little bit nicer in Scala. So the reason is, if I would like to multiply value now with 10, yeah. So value is a random variable. So actually, I would have to use something like this, yeah. Multiply with 10, and then if I return the value scaled, yeah, then actually I believe then we should see here an 80 returned, because now I have multiplied with 10. Does he run it? Okay, so this is what you should write in Java. Okay, dot multiply with 10. Okay. And yeah, there you see the 80. Yeah, so the result is multiplied with 10. We get here an error because it's not the expected result of this problem. So you see my modification here is actually working. And the thing is that in Scala, you can have method names which are just a symbol. So I can write dot multiply with 10. So let's run this again. Okay. And now comes a little bit of syntax magic. Yeah, you see, it's also the 80. The syntax magic is that in Scala, you can leave the point and the bracket out. Okay, that's all. So actually, this is just a short notation for call the multiplication method with this argument. And another syntax magic is that you can have left arguments and right arguments. So I can also write 10 multiplied with value, which will call on value the multiplication method again. Okay, so that was just a small excursion that if your programming language supports some kind of syntax magic, there are also other frameworks in the Java universe that can do this, then you can write your problem in a very nice way. I mean, this here is the valuation of the call option under the Black-Scholes model, and nobody sees the numerical method behind it. It's hidden, but it's nicely hidden. Yeah? When you like to create a new random number generator, change this implementation. When you like to create a different way of transforming it to normal distribution, change this implementation, and so on. Okay, so that was three or four, or if you take the analytic one, five different ways of calculating the call option price. Let's go back to our slides. Okay, so I already mentioned random variables and Brownian motions. So shortly review the Brownian motion. So that was just an application where we generated a single random variable, namely the normal distributed x at time capital T. Yeah. So, but the Brownian motion is a stochastic process. And here I have copied from, actually this is the definition in my book here, from the script, or maybe the definition of the Brownian motion. I have copied it here, and you see it's a stochastic process which initially starts in zero. Okay, and then the other important thing is that if you have a time discretization, so here is our concept of a time discretization, then you know that the increments of the Brownian motion, so the differences WTI minus WT0, are normally distributed independent increments. Yeah? And here we have the specification, though this increment is normally distributed with mean zero and variance time step size. Okay, so this allows us to actually construct the Brownian motion. Yeah? This tells us how to construct the Brownian motion at the time discrete points Ti, because I know that WTI is actually just the sum J from 0 to I minus 1 delta WTI. And I know delta WTI is a normally distributed random variable. Each one is independent. So let's generate a vector. So generate a vector delta W T zero up to delta W T n minus one. Yeah, generate a vector, and we know how to generate in the Monte Carlo method a vector of independent normally distributed random variables. So this is a mathematical concept. For this, I like to have an implementation, yeah, and maybe an interface. Yeah, you already saw it, and you see the green one. Actually, maybe it's not good that this one is green. Let's take a different color here because the other one is already green below. This one here is a time discretization. So maybe I have another Java class which creates the time discretization. So in the script, I also have a small picture, yeah, on how we generate the Brownian motion at discrete times. Yeah, we just sample normal distributions and then we just sum these normal distributions up. So conditional that you have arrived here, the next increment is also a normal distribution. Then you draw this random number, and conditional that you have arrived here, the next increment is also a normal distribution, and you draw this random number and you are here. So this is how we can generate a Brownian motion. Okay, so this gives us a recipe on generating the Brownian motion. For this, I like to structure now my code into three parts. So the three parts are the time discretization, the random variable, and the Brownian motion. So let's take also the blue color here. So for these, I specify interfaces. So I do not specify first how I do it. I just specify what they can do. So next thing is just review a few of these implementations. So we already did some of this, but let's start again looking at the random variable. So I mentioned that the random variable, now where is it? I have to move this here away. Oh, it's no longer open. So let's take a look at the interface random variable. Okay, so I already mentioned the random variable is just an object which can perform arithmetic operations. So there are some arithmetic operations here. You can add two random variables, subtract them. It just tells you what you can do with a random variable. It also has a method which can calculate the expectation of a random variable. Where was it? And the variance. and some more stuff. So, for example, here, maybe later in this course, we will also see a conditional expectation and so on. So that is a random variable. So now how do I implement this? And since we talked about computer arithmetic, I have actually two implementations. There are more implementations in this library. One using a floating point double, the other one using a floating point single precision number, so float. Yeah. So these are now the two implementations I would like to look at. Okay, so if you like to find the implementations, you can go here and select open type hierarchy. And you see all kinds of things that implement this. Yeah, and you see here, for example, these ones. Yeah, there are also other implementations here. The random variable as a double array or from a double array is just what you think of it. It's just a vector of floating point doubles. Okay, there is a little bit other magic here, because when the random variable is a constant, so when it's not a stochastic value, I just store a constant and I set this to null, because I do not want to allocate an array of 20 million numbers which are all identical. So there is some kind of optimization here inside, yeah? But you can leave this aside. And if you now look at the implementations here, let's take a look at adding two random variables. So where was this? Here's the add method. You see, there's this little bit of other stuff going on here. Depending on whether this random variable and the argument is deterministic, I just take the sum of the two deterministic values. Or the general case is here, and there you see our Monte Carlo loop over all omegas. So all the loops, so if we go back to our experiment, all the loops which we had here, this big loop around everything, is now inside this class performing the loop there. Okay, looks not so efficient, yeah, but actually the code looks much nicer, and you can make it more efficient by other techniques. Concatenation of operators and so on. Okay, so let's take a look at the other implementation, the float one. And you see it just uses a floating point double array. Okay, it saves a bit of memory. Let's take a look at one other implementation. There is the implementation of getAverage. Yeah, getAverage. And you see that this implementation uses our Kahan summation from our session on computer arithmetic. Okay, so by using this way of encapsulating your methods, you can later improve the implementation without actually changing your outside solution, yeah, your problem here. Yeah, so here we call average, and maybe in a first version, this one was done without Kahan summation. And then you saw the section on Kahan summation and you say, okay, I like to improve how we do this. And you can improve it without changing this code. If you go back to the example where you do the loop, if you would like to do Kahan summation here, you have to do it inside this loop, which becomes very ugly. Okay, now here, the Kahan summation is hidden in the way how we calculate the average. Yeah, the average is a sum with error correction, very simple error correction method, Kahan, divided by the number of realizations. Okay, if the random variable is deterministic, it's just the value itself. That was a small review of the random variable. So the time discretization, I already looked into the time discretization interface. Yeah, and maybe it's clear how a time discretization from an array would look like. So let's very quickly go through this. So we used here a time discretization. This was our interface, the time discretization. It has, for example, a get the time step. And when you look into the implementation, which is here, you have all kinds of constructors which create time discretization from initial value time steps and delta t, yeah, very, very natural. And then in the time discretization, there is, for example, the time step is just the difference of ti plus one and ti. Yeah. Okay, so very trivial implementation, but when you need a time discretization very often, it's maybe much nicer to write get time step instead of always writing this. And the last part is now our Brown in motion. So the Brown in motion, I have several implementations of the Brown in motions. So we used in our code this one here, Brown in motion from a given random number generator. So let's take a look at this. So we use the Brown in motion. The interface tells us what is a Brown in motion, what can it do? And the Brown in motion, here we have also the documentation, yeah, is a vector of normal distributed random variables, each increment independent. And since in our application of the Euler scheme, for example, we often use the increment, we rarely use the W, we often use the delta W, actually this guy provides the increment. Okay, the increment for a given time index or for a given time, which is just look up the time index and you can get a time discretization. So that's the interface. Let's take a look at how it is implemented. You can also write here at open time type hierarchy and see different implementations, a Brown in bridge, a correlated Brown in motion. This one here is the uncorrelated Brown in motion with a random number generator. So there is the time discretization, how many normal distributed random numbers are in this vector, and how many sample paths do we generate? What is the random number generator? And somewhere below, there is the code that does the magic, and the code that does the magic is here. Yeah? And you see that this is actually just using the normal distribution inverse of the cumulative distribution function to convert a uniform random number. So where is the uniform? Here. So which converts the uniform random numbers to the normal distributed one? And this is the Brown in increments. So again, a numerical method encapsulated in this implementation, specified by an interface, gives us the abstraction. So today I reviewed these three classes. My next application is, let's do now time discretization of stochastic processes. So a numerical scheme, an Euler scheme. And maybe I do this in another session in more details, but I will maybe use 5 minutes to already give you the main idea. Yeah, so then you can maybe start working on some exercises. Okay, so, I would like to do an implementation of the Euler scheme used in our application, financial modeling. And here I have something which looks like an Euler scheme. So we start with a stochastic process. Dy is mu dt plus lambda dw. Okay, this is just, I renamed the x a y and I renamed the sigma a lambda. So this is how you know it from our definition of the Euler scheme. And from that we have the Euler scheme. of this process. So the Euler scheme of this process, written down here. The next value is the previous value plus mu at the previous value delta t plus lambda at the previous value times delta w. But now I generalize this a little bit. And what I did as a generalization is that, recall in our session on the Euler scheme, it's sometimes very nice, it improves the numerical methods by converting your coordinate. So instead of doing the Euler scheme for the stock in the Black-Scholes model for the S, you do the Euler scheme for the logarithm. Yeah? And then you transform back by taking exponential of the Euler scheme approximation, you get the stock. So the generalization is that often the situation is that you have a function. In our case of the Black-Scholes model, this would be the exponential. And your stochastic process is actually a function of another stochastic process. Why? And you like to do the Euler scheme for this other stochastic process. Then, of course, you do the Euler scheme for this other stochastic process. So you do the Euler scheme for the y. Actually, there should be a y tilde here. There's a small typo. You do the Euler scheme for the y tilde. And then from that, you create the x process by applying the function f. So I apply the function f to get then the x, the Euler scheme for the x. So this middle part here looks a little bit like in Itô's lemma. So actually the situation is that we combine Euler scheme with an application of Itô's lemma. And this situation is very often in mathematical finance. You don't do the Euler scheme for the stochastic process you see, you do it for some other coordinate and then you transform. And this relates now to my remark, design for extension. Let's consider from the beginning that we are in this situation. So here are many generalizations. The lambda is a matrix. Yeah? The lambda depends on y. And I do, after the Euler scheme, I do a transformation. Okay, so I like to implement an Euler scheme which performs these steps. Yeah? So example is the Black-Scholes model. So in the Black-Scholes model, the stock is a one-dimensional stochastic process. It's driven by one Brownian motion. So it's a one-dimensional Brownian motion. So we have n and m is equal to 1. This transformation, the function f, is in the Black-Scholes model the exponential. And then the initial value of the transformed variable is the logarithm of s. And the mu and the lambda become r minus 1/2 sigma squared, and the lambda becomes sigma. Yeah, so that was the reason why I used a different letter instead of sigma to avoid this confusion. And then you have the Euler scheme of your variable x. So this is also with a tilde here, the x tilde, which is the function f of y tilde of ti. So I like to do an implementation of this, of an Euler scheme. And the next step is related to my remark on composition. Which parameter should be where? Yeah. So some parameters are model parameters, namely the initial value, the drift, the lambda, and this function f, the state space transformation. I do not want to hard code this for every mathematical model, so I specify an interface for a mathematical model which specifies these parameters here. These are the model specification. Yeah, the initial value of F inverse from the so the initial state, yeah, the transformation you use, the drift of the transformed variable, and the diffusion coefficient of the transformed variable. These parameters specify the model, and once I have given a model, I can do an Euler scheme on this. So we have already reviewed this part here. So I would like to now do two more classes, two more abstractions. One is the mathematical model. So one is the mathematical model. So this would be the initial value. So y of zero, which corresponds to s of zero in the Black-Scholes model. The transformation f, which corresponds in the Black-Scholes model to the exponential. The drift mu of the transformed variable, which in this Black-Scholes model is r minus 1/2 sigma squared. Yeah. And the diffusion lambda, which in the Black-Scholes model is just the sigma. This is one part. And then I would like to specify or implement an Euler scheme. Yeah. So this is the numerical method. So maybe you can already review these implementations, these classes for yourself. But this one is just doing new point is previous point plus mu delta t plus lambda delta w. And there is another ingredient here. There is the Brownian motion, which is popped in from here. Yeah, there is the time discretization, which is coming from here. Of course, all the variables here are random variables, which is coming from here. And I'm running out of colors. No, I'm not. These parameters here, the mu, the lambda, the initial value are coming from here, specified by the model. So we have a nice decomposition of all our mathematical concepts into different parts of the implementations which play together.